Welcome and thank you for joining us this afternoon for today's Astera Cancer Class, New Treatments and Clinical Trials for Multiple Myeloma, Lymphoma, and Other Blood Disorders. My name is Melissa Hosick, and I'm the Adult Programming Librarian here at the East Brunswick Public Library. Today's program is brought to you by Astera Cancer Care and the library's Just for the Health of It initiative to promote community health and wellness. Our speaker today is Dr. M. Hossein Kazemi, Medical Oncologist and Hematologist at Astera Cancer Care. Please be aware that this talk is being recorded. Attendees are automatically muted and webcams set to off. Within a week, the recording will be available for viewing at ebpl.org/YouTube. If you have any questions, please type them into the chat box. Our speaker will answer questions at the end of the talk. Please be aware that the speaker cannot provide medical advice to attendees during this program. And without further ado, I will turn things over to Dr. Kazemi.
Good afternoon. It's good to be with you, and I'm excited to talk a little bit about multiple myeloma and some other blood disorders and provide you with some updates that are happening within this field. First, let's talk about what is multiple myeloma. Next slide, please. Next. Okay. So multiple myeloma, when we talk about it, it belongs to a group of disorders that we call blood cancers or hematological malignancies. Basically, we have three groups of cells within our blood, red blood cell, platelets, and white blood cell. White blood cells are basically the our immune system, our sort of security system that are supposed to protect us against infection and all sort of foreign or abnormal materials. Like any security force or army, shall we say, they have many types of units or cell types. In this case, these cells are generally produced in the bone marrow. Next slide, please. One of these cells are called plasma cells. Plasma cells are responsible for producing antibodies, proteins that are made by the immune system that can attach to the surface of bacteria, viruses, fungi, and direct the other parts of the immune system to recognize and destroy these threats. We all have become very familiar with the word antibody during the COVID pandemic. So on the left, you can see, say, a group of antibodies basically binding to the surface of virus. And on the right, you see the picture of these plasma cells within the bone marrow. Now, in the normal bone marrow, you are not supposed to have these many plasma cells. It's supposed to be less than 5%. So this picture is actually from a bone marrow of a person with multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma is really the cancer of these plasma cells. Next slide, please. Within a normal bone marrow, you have a diverse group of plasma cells, each of them making a little bit of antibody. Each plasma cell makes a very specific type of antibody. So you have a group of different antibodies that can protect us against a whole host of infectious threats. In multiple myeloma, one of these plasma cells basically gets out of control, starts making more copies of its own, and starts producing too much of that specific antibody, basically takes over the bone marrow. So instead of having this diverse group of plasma cells giving us all sorts of antibodies, you have one very specific plasma cell clone and a high level of that specific antibody and not much else. Sometimes these plasma cells produce the whole antibody. Sometimes they are so distorted that they don't even produce the whole antibody and they just produce a part of antibody called free light chain. Next slide, please. So when we talk about this excess protein, that's produced by these myeloma cells. What are we talking about? When we want to look at the proteins in the blood evaluated in a patient, we run them on a gel. And with the help of electricity current, we separate the proteins. And proteins are separated based on their shape, their size, and other chemical and physical properties. So when you look at the gel, if you look at the middle of the slide, a normal gel in column A, you see like the albumin is there and the rest of proteins are there in small amounts. But in multiple myeloma, you get a very distinct band, as you see in column B at the bottom of the gel, that we call the monoclonal component or M protein, which is, stands for monoclonal protein or MS5. And some people call it myeloma spike, really the same thing. And if you look at part C and part D of the picture, part C shows us a normal protein electrophoresis, basically this process of running the proteins on the gel, just the normal one. And in part D, you see the abnormal one. Basically, you see a peak that's not supposed to be there. It means too much of one specific protein. Whenever you see a spike where it shouldn't be, it means that there is a plasma cell doing what it's not supposed to do. Basically, a plasma cell that's out of control. Next slide, please. So we talked about like these plasma cells getting out of control, producing too much protein, making more copies of itself. So what's the problem of what's the problem with that? What can it do? What damage does it do? There are several. First of all, these myeloma cells in high levels can take over the bone marrow. So there would not be a space for normal cells. So they cannot produce enough blood, enough other white blood cell, enough platelet. So people can become anemic. They feel fatigued. They feel tired all the time. They become prone to infection. These are myeloma cells are immune system cells, but remember, they kind of crowd out every other part of the immune system. So people will become more prone to infection. Furthermore, these plasma cells can these abnormal plasma cells can attack the bone and eat into the bones and give rise to what we call lytic lesions, meaning areas of destruction of the bone. And it progresses, it can be quite painful and it increases risk of fractures. Also, the excess protein that's produced by these cells sometimes can precipitate in the kidneys and cause kidney failure. Sometimes with certain specific antibodies, some types of antibodies, if the concentration is high enough, it can make the blood too thick, too viscous, and it can cause problems for normal blood flow, cause eye problems, shortness of breath, that sort of stuff. And sometimes these plasma cells these abnormal plasma cells, myeloma cells, can go out of the bone marrow, give rise to tumors or masses around the spinal cord and put pressure on the nerves, cause pain and even paralysis. Next slide, please. So, part of this slide is not coming up. First of all, why and how? Some of the questions that people ask is that, why does this happen? The short answer is, unfortunately, we do not know. There is no identified risk factor for myeloma that we know about, environmental risk factor. So unlike lung cancer that we know smoking is a risk factor, or colon cancer, which has certain risk factors, for myeloma, we really haven't identified any reason. We also have not identified any genetic risk factors for multiple myeloma. We know it's more common in certain ethnicities, but that's basically the only thing that we have identified so far. How does this happen and what's the timeline? Myeloma doesn't happen suddenly. it basically develops over years and years. In fact, nobody develops full-blown myeloma all of a sudden. It starts as what we call MGUS, which stands for monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance. It's basically a big fancy phrase for a small plasma cell clone that's producing a little bit of protein, and we don't know whether it will lead to something more sinister or not. It's quite a common condition, especially after age 60 and especially after age 75. It's quite a common condition. You have one plasma cell clone that's not as aggressive. Basically, it's dividing a little bit, producing a little bit of protein, but it's not causing any problem. And in 80 to 90% of the cases, it will never cause any problem. It will never turn into something more sinister. And a lot of times people are diagnosed by accident when they have blood work done for other reasons, sometimes just a normal blood work, sometimes when they have other problems such as neuropathy, such as arthritis, they test for this, they find this, they refer it to us. And sometimes it starts progressing. In a minority of cases, it starts progressing. And it becomes something we call a smoldering myeloma, meaning that now the clone has acquired other damages to its genome, has acquired new mutations. Now it's expanding, it's larger. The amount of protein that's secreting is higher, but it still has not caused any damage, meaning that there is no kidney damage, no anemia, no increased infection, no bone lesion, still asymptomatic. Up to this point, for now, I mean, mostly we monitor it. And if we find it at this level. And some of these smoldering myeloma cases will eventually progress to multiple myeloma, will acquire even more mutations, and the cells will become even more aggressive and progress to multiple myeloma. Next slide, please. So this MGUS and smoldering myeloma, as I said, by definition, these patients should be asymptomatic. So it's found by accident. And when they refer it to a hematologist and oncologist, and we quite have a number of these consults, one of the more common consults that we get. Our first job is to, first of all, confirm the diagnosis, and additional testing to confirm that this is, in fact, a monoclonal protein. And second, and more importantly, make sure that they are truly asymptomatic, meaning that we have to make sure their calcium is not high, because high calcium can sometimes be a result of multiple myeloma. The kidney function is not impacted. Patients are not anemic. There is no bone lesion and such. And part three is to risk stratify them. Basically, we do have tools based on the type of the protein, based on the level of the protein, basically to kind of say, okay, this person has a low risk of progression, less than 5%. We can just check labs once a year. I'm not that worried. Or say this person has more than 20, 30% risk of progression to myeloma in the next few years. We need to follow him up more frequently. We need to see him, say, every 3 months. These studies, some of them are blood work. Sometimes if these protein levels are higher or we are more concerned, our patient has some vague symptoms, they require imaging. Sometimes it can be done with simple X-ray. Sometimes people require MRI or PET scan just to be 100% sure that, in fact, no damage has happened so far. And sometimes we even do bone marrow biopsy to take a closer look at what's happening in the bone marrow. And a lot of times when we find these patients, we do all the work of, we determine that the patients are in fact completely asymptomatic. Then we come up with a follow-up plan depending on the risk profile. We say, okay, you come back in 3 months, or you come back in 6 months, or 1 year. And the patient asks us, is there any way to prevent the progression or reduce the risk of progression to multiple myeloma? Can we do anything? And the answer is, yes and no. Up until recently, there was nothing to be done. We would observe them closely to start treatment as soon as they develop multiple myeloma. They meet the criteria for multiple myeloma. In recent years, they did a trial and they said, okay, one of the treatments for multiple myeloma is a pill that people take at home. It's reasonably well tolerated. It has some side effects, but overall manageable. It's called Revlimid. We will talk about that a little bit more. I said, okay, it's a pill. Most people can tolerate it with reasonable side effect. How about if we wait until the patient develops multiple myeloma and then we start this pill? How about we give it to people who are at high risk of progression to myeloma? Basically, they have high risk a smoldering myeloma. Let's give them this pill and see what happens. Next slide. Next slide. Yeah. So, as expected, it did delay the progression to multiple myeloma. So if you look at part A of the picture, the red line is in part A is people who were just observed without any treatment. The blue line were people with high-risk smoldering myeloma who were started on Revlimid. And as you can see at 36 months, at 3 years, in the observation group, no intervention, around a quarter of people have developed myeloma. But in the intervention group, the Revlimid group, there were very few cases of multiple myeloma. But the life expectancy was the same in both groups because the observation group, they were being monitored closely. So when they developed myeloma, they were starting treatment. So basically there was no difference in survival, but we managed to delay the myeloma for some people, basically for 25% of the people who were supposed to develop myeloma, we delayed it. So it has become quite a very controversial topic in oncology. And it's one of the more difficult discussions that we have with this patient when we have with patients that we, when we see a patient with high risk smoldering myeloma. Why is it controversial? Isn't it always good to delay cancer? The answer is that it seems that this Revlimid pill delays the development of myeloma, but it doesn't cure people. It just delays it, basically delayed the development of myeloma. So those 25% that have not developed the myeloma because of Revlimid will probably eventually develop it, most likely. And by the time they developed it, they have become resistant to one of the medications we have for myeloma. So at the end, like a few years down the road, will it end up being better or did we just start treatment earlier? And also one other thing to consider is that 75% of the people did not, in the observation group, did not develop myeloma at all. So those 75% were treated in the intervention arm. 75% of people are treated when they didn't need to. So it has, that's why it has become a very controversial issue. We are, there is ongoing research to try to better identify who will develop myeloma and who will not develop myeloma. This way we can refine the selection for treating for Revlimid. And of course, when a patient presents with high risk smoldering myeloma, this is a discussion that we will have with them, and it depends on the patient preferences as well. But some oncologists advocate for this. Some oncologists, quite a majority, still say it's better to wait until they develop multiple myeloma and then treat them properly with a combination of medication. This way, people are not exposed to a medication when they don't need to. Next slide. So how does a patient with multiple myeloma present? Say, up until even now, most patients will never know that they have MGUS or a smoldering myeloma. Basically, those conditions are asymptomatic. They are diagnosed when they become symptomatic with multiple myeloma. In the old days, people presented at advanced stages of myeloma, when they had fractures, when they had severe kidney failure, when they were very anemic. These days, fortunately, because there is more awareness among physicians of multiple myeloma, and we have much better diagnostic methods, people are diagnosed much earlier. But still, some people are diagnosed after they are admitted to hospital for kidney failure or fracture. Most people are referred to a hematologist and say they have anemia. We work them up. We find out that they have multiple myeloma. Sometimes people have like this pain that they have. They do imaging outpatient and they see there was a lytic lesion, and then they are referred to us and we do the workup. We find out that they have myeloma. Fortunately, a lot of times these days, patients are diagnosed before they develop irreversible damage. Next slide. So now a patient presents with multiple myeloma. What are the steps that we take? What's the workup that we do? First of all, people need bone marrow biopsy. Basically, both for confirmation or even when we know based on the blood work that they definitely have myeloma, it's still important to do the bone marrow biopsy. Why? Bone marrow biopsy will give us very valuable information. Basically, we can send these myeloma cells for DNA sequencing and find out exactly what sort of damage they have, what mutations they have, what deletions they have in their chromosomes, in their DNA. And based on this mutation profile, this DNA damage profile, then we can risk stratify them. Basically, we can say, we can make predictions on how aggressive this myeloma will behave. Sometimes it impacts our treatment decision, saying, okay, this myeloma based on this mutation, I think will respond better to this specific medication. So regardless of whether we know the diagnosis for sure or not, a bone marrow biopsy is still very valuable. Sometimes when people present with large bone lesions and they need to go to operating room, basically to have procedures done for that bone lesion, the surgeon can take a sample of the bone lesion and we can send a test from those cells. That might, in that case, we might not need the bone marrow biopsy necessarily, but vast majority of cases, they do need the biopsy. They will, of course, need blood work, urine tests, because, as I said, these proteins sometimes are excreted in the urine. So it's important for some cases to do the urine test as well. And everybody needs imaging, preferably MRI or PET scan, if the insurance approves it. Next slide. So, common questions at diagnosis. The most common question that I get when patients present with myeloma is that, is this curable or not? Now, multiple myeloma, for majority of patients up until now, is not curable, meaning that we cannot completely eradicate the disease, but we can control the disease for quite a long time. It used to be that in 60s and 70s, we had very limited treatment options for patients with myeloma. And unfortunately, at that time, the life expectancy of a person who was diagnosed with myeloma was quite limited. But in the past 20 years, there has been such significant progress in myeloma. In fact, multiple myeloma had the highest number of new drug approval than any other cancer. And these days, the prognosis of somebody diagnosed with myeloma is dramatically different. As I will show in the next slide, the average life expectancy of a person, yes, these are the, just to give you a glimpse of how many new drugs are approved. The average life expectancy of a person diagnosed with myeloma in the United States with the current treatments that we have is over 10 years. So, but keep in mind that's just a median. So by definition, half of people will do better than that. Half of people, unfortunately, do worse than that. but just shows like how much progress we have made coming from like 2-3 years in the past to over 10 years. And there are new medications on the horizon. There are a lot of trials. We'll talk about a couple of them for myeloma that probably soon the prognosis will even be much better than this. So for a patient that we see, well, I'll tell them, okay, the life expectancy for most patients is over years, is number of years, and probably it will improve further. So if we control the disease properly until new treatments are available, your prognosis will be even better than that. A group of patients will do very well, and sometimes occasionally we see people who get the treatment and their disease is even controlled at 20 years. So there is quite a heterogeneity in how patients respond. But just to give at diagnosis, we try to reassure the patients that with proper treatment, most patients will do quite well. Can we go back to the previous slide, please? Okay. So yes, that was just a question to how long do I have? Part of that also depends on the genetic profile of the myeloma. As I mentioned, one of the reasons we do the bone marrow biopsy, based on the genetic profile, we do have some idea. We can predict to some degree who will have a longer response, who will have a shorter response. One other question that patients ask, anything I can do, any dietary fact, anything with diet that they can do? What I always tell the patients that try to maintain a healthy, balanced diet. That's the best thing that you can do for myeloma. There is no specific food that you need to eat or you need to avoid for myeloma. And it also applies to most cancer treatments for other malignancies. One thing I would say is that a lot of times patients try to take supplements, sometimes vitamins, sometimes herbal supplements. I try to basically warn the patient to be a bit careful, because with herbal supplements, a lot of times we really don't know exactly what are the ingredients that they take. And some of the ingredients occasionally can interfere with treatment. In fact, with myeloma, for example, there is some concern that high intake of vitamin C, for example, can sometimes interfere with treatment. So I just, as a patient, like in terms of diet, eat whatever, just eat a normal, healthy, balanced diet. But if you are taking supplements or vitamins, let me know so we can discuss it, make sure that you are not taking anything that might impact your treatment. One other common question, what stage is my disease? Now, the question of a stage is very important for most cancers. For example, in breast cancer or colon cancer, a stage is extremely important. A stage one or two, easily cured with surgery, sometimes combination of surgery, radiation, chemotherapy, excellent outcome. A stage three, high risk of relapse. A stage four, for breast and colon and other solid tumors like lung, means that usually we cannot cure it. It's just palliative. The outcome is more limited. In blood cancers, a stage does not have the same meaning, because by definition, these are like blood cells, bone marrow. So they are kind of all over to begin with. So it's the concept of a stage really doesn't apply here. In the past, they had a staging system for myeloma, a stage 1, 2, 3, based on protein levels, based on some other factors. With the new treatments, really that old staging system, it really doesn't help us that much. Basically, it really doesn't impact how we treat the patient. It's really is not good at predicting who will do better or not. The genetic profile of the myeloma cells, honestly, is much more predictive of response and outcome. So it's still used, you know, in trials and for some research purposes, but the answer is that, yes, there a staging system, but these days doesn't mean as much. One other common question that we get in multiple myeloma is that, how long is the treatment? Am I ever done with this treatment, or do I need to be on treatment for the rest of my life? So up until recently, in most cases, having multiple myeloma meant that you would be on treatment for most of the time. The treatment was continuous, you know, sometimes more heavy duty treatment, like in the beginning, sometimes like a gentler maintenance treatment, but vast majority of cases meant you are in treatment. With recent advances in technology, sometimes in the maintenance phase of the disease that we will talk about, we are able, like some oncologists have started saying that, okay, if somebody's disease is very well controlled, maybe we can give them a break, basically. If the disease is very well suppressed, then maybe we can give them a break from treatment, which we'll talk about shortly. Next slide. This slide was just to give you an idea. These are all these boxes that you see, all these new medications have been approved basically in the past 17 years. And we are, of the treatments that we had before this time period, we are only using one treatment. So this is how dramatically the field of multiple myeloma has changed. And soon there will be more treatment approvals for myeloma. Next slide, please. And yes, it shows the improved outcome of myeloma patients over the years. This chart that you see shows like the percentage of people that are alive like for more than 5 years since the time of diagnosis. And as you see, like in the 60s and 70s, unfortunately, small percentage, like 25% of people were alive for more than 5 years. But now this number has really steadily been increasing. Next slide, please. Okay, so when we start treatment with for multiple myeloma, what's our goal? Our goal is to kill as many plasma cell, abnormal plasma cell, myeloma cells as possible, and to get rid of that excess protein. Basically, if you look at the graph on the left side, the protein electrophoresis, our goal is to get rid of that monoclonal spike, that myeloma spike, shall we say. And we have criteria to see how deep the response is. Basically, ideally, we would like to get rid of at least 90% of the abnormal protein and the plasma cells, what we call very good partial response. And ideally, we would like to get rid of the excess protein completely, what we call complete response. But what you need to keep in mind is, even in complete response, even if we don't see any evidence of abnormal protein in the blood, there are still these myeloma cells hiding in the bone marrow. Recently, we have developed, we now have the technology to evaluate the bone marrow in far more accurately, basically to be able to identify one myeloma cell even within 1 million normal cell. And that's what we call minimal residual disease negativity. And we are hoping that these very sensitive techniques can help us identify patients who will do better, maybe can go off treatment, and basically help us individualize or personalize the treatment better. Next slide, please. So, new diagnosis of multiple myeloma. In these days, for multiple myeloma, the upfront treatment or the induction treatment usually is done with a combination of medications. We use combination of three or sometimes four medications. And there are several classes of medication. I mean, I'm not going to go into details, but one class is called proteasome inhibitor. These myeloma cells make a lot of protein, and in the process, a lot of junk is produced inside the cell. that the cells need to get rid of. Proteasome inhibitors basically interfere with that, doesn't let the cell get myeloma cell get rid of the byproducts or the junks. So the myeloma cell will die as the result of excess protein that's producing. And usually it's given with an injection once a week, either under the skin or sometimes intravenously. IMiDs, the Revlimid, or the generic name is lenalidomide, and the newer version, pomalidomide, are pills that patients take at home. Monoclonal antibodies are sort of like a smart missile. They are actually antibodies themselves, but they go and attach to the surface of myeloma cell specifically and direct the other parts of the immune system basically to destroy the myeloma cell, basically recruit the rest of the immune cell to mobilize against the myeloma cells. And quite very, very effective and has improved the outcomes for these cells, for these patients. And steroids, the steroids like prednisone or Decadron that a lot of us might have been prescribed for allergies and stuff in the past, these steroids are actually toxic to plasma cells as well. So we usually incorporate them into the upfront treatment. And of course, the treatment differs from patient to patient, depending on other medical problems that they have, depending on the type of myeloma, how aggressive the myeloma is. But for vast majority of patients, usually we do a combination of three or four medications from these four class of drugs that I mentioned. And one good thing about these treatments are that none of them are very old school chemotherapy that have a lot of side effects. Basically, these are mostly targeted treatments that are quite well tolerated. And even people, a lot of patients in their late 80s, even early 90s can tolerate this treatment and not only control their myeloma, but have a good quality of life, basically, to be able to function normally. We have patients on myeloma treatment that continue with their regular work outside of home. Next slide, please. So, and just to give you an idea, the green bar is the response rate, meaning any reduction in basically protein production by these myeloma cells or reduction in the volume of this, the disease. And the green bar is basically how well, number of cases, percentage of cases that there is more than 90% reduction in disease burden. And if you see on this graph, the older treatments are to the left and the newer regimens that we have are to the right. And if you look at the newer treatments like RVD or CRD, it's almost 100% response rate. So upfront, like almost all patients respond to the treatment, and quite a number of them, like 75 to 80% of the patients, they have more than 90% reduction in their disease. So very good treatments, and with newer treatments that are coming, basically with intensifying the upfront treatment, probably these responses will even improve. This is just to give you an idea how effective the myeloma treatments have become in recent years. Next slide, please. So this is just to give an idea of how multiple myeloma behaves generally. So if we start from the left, in the asymptomatic part, it's MGUS or smoldering myeloma, and sometimes people are diagnosed during this part, sometimes not, they are diagnosed when they become symptomatic. And then we start the upfront treatment and we suppress the disease and it goes into remission. But in majority of cases, unfortunately, eventually the disease will become resistant to the upfront treatment and it comes back. Fortunately, these days, we have many lines of treatment. There are a lot of patients go to 6, 7, 8 lines of treatment. And we'll control the disease with second line. After a while, the disease becomes resistant again. Then we go to the third line, and so on and so on. So basically, these days, behaving more like a chronic disease. In a minority of patients, of course, they can have a very long remission period. I believe it was a couple of weeks ago that I saw a patient that was disease-free more than 20 years after the initial diagnosis and treatment. So there is quite a little bit of variability, but this is just the general, to give you a general idea of what's a typical multiple myeloma course. Next slide, please. So this is just to give you an idea of, it's very important that when we start treatment and we first start treatment, first line treatment, or what we call induction in oncology, try to get a deep response, try to beat down the disease as much as possible. Because a study after a study over the years have shown that the deeper the initial response is, the longer it takes for the disease to come back, and the better the long-term outcome is. So if we manage to do more than 90% reduction in the disease, in the monoclonal protein and plasma cell, much better prognosis than somebody who has 50% reduction. If we manage to get rid of the protein completely, this patient will do even much, much better. So it has become very important to, first of all, try to get a deep response upfront. Second of all, see how deep the response is, basically. How best we, how much reduction we have achieved in the volume of plasma cells in the bone marrow. Next slide, please. And in the patients that they have become MRD negative, what does that mean? It means that now we have the techniques that look at basically identify the genetic signature of these myeloma cells. And then when we finish with the induction after a few months of treatment or after the bone marrow transplant, which is part of treatment for some patients, not all patients with myeloma, they will go back and see if that genetic signature is still present in the bone marrow. And that technique is very sensitive. As I said, they can identify one myeloma cell within 1 million normal cells. Patients who become MRD negative, basically that test comes back negative, they do much better. They're like even 36 months out, there is the vast majority of them haven't had any relapse. But in patients who are MRD positive, then there is much higher chance of relapse at 36 months. Next slide, please. So this is the technique that we are using. There are several ways of assessing basically minimal residual disease status. But the one that's most sensitive and best studied is provided by basically this company, Clonoseq. And after discussion within the group, we decided to basically obtain the kits from this company and use it when appropriate. Of course, it's not helpful in all conditions, but at least have the kits so when the oncologist thinks that it's appropriate and it will impact decision and it can help us better prognosticate, we can send for this test within our clinic. Next slide, please. I'm not going to go to details for all myeloma treatments that we have that will require several hours of presentation. But one thing that's a couple of things that are on the horizon for myeloma and might improve the outcomes dramatically. One of these is CAR T cells, basically chimeric antigen receptor T cells. It's when they get the T cells, which are part of immune system as well. They get those cells from patient's own blood, and they genetically engineer those cells in the lab, basically train them to recognize and destroy the myeloma cells, and then grow those cells, and then infuse it back to the patient. And it has had some significant success in myeloma patients. One of these products is already approved by FDA, and another product probably will be approved shortly in the next couple of years. And so far, what it has achieved is in a lot of patients, it can control the disease for quite some time. Can it cure the myeloma? Can it eradicate the myeloma? At this point, it doesn't seem so, but it can add significantly to the amount of time that we can keep the myeloma under control. Next slide, please. So, as I mentioned, we have very good treatments for multiple myeloma. These days, the myeloma patients do much, much better than before. But unfortunately, still, for a majority of these patients, even with all these lines of treatment, they will eventually progress and they will some of them will run out of options. So there is always, we are always trying to improve the treatment landscape for multiple myeloma. So there are a lot of trials going on for multiple myeloma, some of them basically modifying the existing treatment. But one important part is to try to identify new treatment agents, basically brand new mechanisms of treating multiple myeloma. And one of those trials that I'm very happy and excited that we have managed to open in Astera is basically a brand new class of medications that have never been used in multiple myeloma before. And we are hoping that this will be a new class of medication to help these patients. In human cells, well, basically in all cells, the DNA is wrapped around certain proteins that can manage control gene expression and gene activity. And one of the, and those proteins themselves are controlled by other proteins that are active in the cells. And one of those proteins is called SET2 that basically has several roles in control of gene expression and interacts with other proteins that are involved basically in DNA quality control, DNA damage repair, etc. Now, for quite some time, for past several years, it has been more and more recognized that SET2 is the dysregulation of SET2 and overactivity can be, is implicated in multiple myeloma and certain types of lymphoma, such as diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. So there has been this endeavor to try to develop inhibitors for SET2 that can be used in the clinic to see if they can help improve outcomes for patients with hematological malignancies, with certain types of blood cancers. Next slide, please. So yes, that this regulation of SET2 in basically cell lines from multiple myeloma and diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, we have recognized in animal model, like there has been a lot of publication. We have known for some time that this is one of the pathways for disease activity. Next slide. So this now there is this molecule, basically a company. They screened a large library of small molecules to find a molecule that is very specific for this protein, SET2, that basically inhibits this protein and doesn't interact with much else in the cell, so it doesn't cause side effects, and it's potent enough, and it's safe to use in humans. And they come up with this molecule, EZM0414. Eventually, I mean, if it's successful, they will come up with an easier name for it. And now they have, basically, they tried it in cell line. Next slide, please. They tried it in cell line. And if you, they basically added it to the culture of multiple myeloma cell lines and diffuse large B-cell lymphoma cell lines. And they compared it when this molecule was added to the culture versus no molecule. And as you see, the black line is when there is no, basically when the normal culture without any addition. So the cells you see are growing and multiplying, increasing exponentially. And the red line is basically the high concentration of this molecule. And as you see, at those concentration, it basically completely inhibited the cell growth in culture. And next, they tried it in animals just to make sure that this is safe and this is tolerable. It doesn't cause any organ damaging animals. And it was safe at doses that were designed for human trial, didn't cause any significant problems. And then they approached several cancer centers, and now it's going to be open in 8 sites in the United States. We were actually the first site that officially opened it last week. It's going to be open in MD Anderson Cancer Center in Texas, Cornell in New York, and several other places in the United States. Next slide. And the company have been in communication with FDA and have been getting feedback from the FDA. And actually, just last week, FDA fast-tracked it, this trial, which allows for the company to be in better communication with FDA, basically. So we are quite excited. This is the a brand new class of medication for multiple myeloma. And we are hoping that it will add to our arsenal to help the patients and improve their outcomes. So this trial is for patients who have progressed in a couple of lines of previous treatment. So it's not for patients who are brand new diagnosis, for patients who have progressed, have received those medications that I mentioned and need other options or could benefit from new options. And of course, patients who are enrolled on these trials are very closely monitored. It's a pill that patients take at home. So if we find this to be effective, it would be very exciting because it's quite convenient for the patients. And hopefully it will improve the outcomes for patients with multiple myeloma. And next slide. So this was the material that I had presented for myeloma. I will just, I know we are almost out of time, but I will just briefly mention that fortunately we have a number of other trials for hematological malignancies at Astera, including follicular lymphoma, a treatment, tazemetostat, that's already approved by FDA. Now they want, we want to try it to see whether it works better in combination with other treatments or not. Basically, to try to do it in combination with two other medications that are already used in follicular lymphoma. Currently, it's used mostly as a single agent. And we have had several patients in that trial. And for another hematological problem called MDS, high-risk MDS, it's a condition that basically, it's almost a cancer of stem cells in the bone marrow, and a lot of times can progress to acute myeloid leukemia. There is a trial of combination of venetoclax, a pill that has basically improved the outcome significantly in acute leukemia. Now we are moving it up front, basically try to use it earlier in the course of disease to see if it improves the outcomes of patients with high-risk MDS, basically preventing them from progressing to acute myeloid leukemia, which we have had open. And for low-risk MDS, basically where the problem is usually more anemia, we have opened the trial for that as well in the past 3 months. And we are in talks to open trials for other hematological malignancies as well. So hopefully I'll be back soon with updates with new trials that we have opened that Astera. So I'll stop now and I'll be more than happy to answer any questions that you might have.
So if you have any questions, please type them into the chat box. As a reminder, our speaker cannot provide medical advice to attendees. So we have one question. Is there anything in the scientific literature or anecdotally that supports treatment of MGUS to reduce the likelihood of progression to smoldering myeloma and multiple myeloma, or to alleviate symptoms of MGUS, for example, neuropathy?
So Yes. Sometimes MGUS, you know, even at small amounts, that protein that's produced can cause symptoms like, sometimes neuropathy, sometimes other problems. So sometimes it's not very common, but occasionally when it can contribute to unusual symptoms, sometimes dermatological problems, sometimes neuropathy, etc. If we think that the neuropathy is coming from MGUS, yes, there are agents that we use for myeloma, then we use it to suppress that clone, reduce the amount of protein, basically, to help the neuropathy. So yes, if, and that's a big if, because a lot of times people have MGUS and have neuropathy, but those conditions are not related. And there are tests, there are criteria we use to basically see whether these two are related or not, to determine whether these two are related or not. If we think so, yes, we use some of the agents that we use for myeloma to suppress that that protein production as much as possible. In terms of a smoldering myeloma, yes, that rev limit that I mentioned, yes, there is a trial. It shows it delays the progression of smoldering myeloma to multiple myeloma. But again, it comes with a lot of nuances and controversies. Whether it benefits the patients in the long run or just delays the inevitable, there is a lot of discussion about that. So it becomes a discussion between the oncologist and patient, and of course the patient preferences, what we've called informed decision, patient-centric approach plays a big part there. But yes, there is that option.
Another question, are any of the treatments mentioned, such as CAR T-cell or epizyme, being used to treat lymphoma?
Yes. Very good question. So the trial that I mentioned, the epizyme, yes, it's both for multiple myeloma and diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, an aggressive form of the myeloma, of lymphoma. CAR T, yes, CAR T is a general concept. So we have CAR T for multiple myeloma. We do have CAR T for lymphoma that is being used. And there are even more types of CAR, basically these chimeric antigen receptor T cells that are being produced for other cancers. For example, soon we are trying to open a trial for pancreatic cancer, for example. Basically the same concept, trying to get the cells, the lymphomas, the lymphocytes, which are part of the immune system, engineer them in a way to recognize the cancer cell and then infuse it back to the patient. So yes, there are CARs are there for lymphoma, for myeloma, hopefully soon for other cancers as well.
The next question is, how is plasma different than the other portions of the blood? And this is not the same as MDS, which affects the stem cells, correct?
So yes, myeloma, multiple myeloma, it's different from MDS. Basically, all the blood cells come from the stem cells, pluripotent stem cells that we have in our bone marrow. And MDS usually, yes, these are stem cells. But multiple myeloma is a disorder that happens a little bit later down the line of differentiation. Basically, those stem cells differentiate to lymphocytes. Those lymphocytes eventually will evolve and differentiate to plasma cells. And if those plasma cells go cancerous, that's multiple myeloma. So it's in a different part from MDS. About plasma, just wanted to differentiate between plasma cell and plasma. Plasma is basically the liquid portion of the blood. In the blood, we have basically the blood cells, the proteins, and then we have the liquid parts, basically the fluid part, which is plasma. Plasma cells, basically it was a name that's a historic name of these cells that they called it that. So plasma and plasma cells are two different things.
And I don't think we have any more questions. So thank you, Dr. Kazemi, for taking time to present on this topic and for answering our questions. And thank you, everyone, for joining us for today's talk. Take care and stay safe.